Thank you so much for doing the session, even when you're not feeling that well.
Oh, well, it's a pleasure. Listening to his music and talking about him is a really great distraction when you're not feeling well. But you'll have to excuse my voice. As you can hear, I'm rather croaky. So yes, I mean, he's one of the greatest all-round musicians and composers of the 20th century. And I will be talking about that, and I'll be playing some brief excerpts of his music. Before I started, I wanted to know, what do you know about him, or what of his music do you know, I suppose, or have heard of? Anything which springs to mind?
We'll know West Side Story.
West Side Story, of course, absolutely.
I also know and have copies of the other five musicals.
Okay, excellent. So we've got a good few musicals, yes.
I know that he was very fond of Maria Callas.
Indeed, he was one of the first people to conduct her, first non-American to conduct her. You're absolutely right, yes, yes. Anything else?
I don't like his Chichester songs particularly. I listened once.
He's Jewish.
He wouldn't be here unless he was Jewish. I mean, it's interesting that the things which you're initially said, West Side Story and his popular stuff, it's the most best known parts about him. I think he would be a bit disappointed in that. I think he saw his legacy as being one of the prime musicians across a broad genre. And he's come down to be remembered for one or two things. Whilst really, I hope by the end of the evening, you'll see what an amazing character he was in terms of the range of his contribution. So the way this can work best for me, actually, I'll put a PowerPoint up, but just come on in and interrupt me if you've got a question as we're going through, because I won't be able to see you on the screen. So please do that as we're going through. So what I'm going to be covering today is six key things, actually. I'll talk about his upbringing, his relationships, his interests outside music. I'll also be talking about how he made his professional breakthrough. This is quite unique. Normally it happens over a period of time. He made it in one day, the 14th of November, 1943. His life changed, and I'll explain how that all happened. Now, I'm also going to be talking about him as a classical virtuoso, really, and probably one of the best conductors of the 20th century. He was the long-term musical director of the New York Philharmonic and a highly talented pianist. He was also probably the prime musical educator of the 20th century. And he did something called Young People's Concerts, which I don't know if any of you have heard of, but they were amazing at the time, and they introduced millions to classical music. He was also a composer in a huge variety of styles, including symphonic and orchestral work, ballet, film, theater, choral, opera, and so on. Best known for West Side Story, probably, Wonderful Town, the film On the Waterfront and On the Town. And then we'll be talking about what he was really like. He was a charming man, compelling, shocking, highly energetic. He had an overriding need for communication, attention, and love. And he was never totally fulfilled. Okay, I'm going to start off with a brief, short documentary about him, which kind of gives you a flavor of those things I've just tried to cover. It just lasts a minute and a half or so.
Ein Mann, der an vielen, vielen Ecken und Enden brannte und eben auch andere Leute begeistern konnte.
For those students like myself, we never dreamed, we never realized that a great personality like that could take the time and would have the generosity to simply give so much to the next generation.
So my father took me to a young people's concert when I was 9 years old. Leonard Bernstein started talking to me about how excited he was about the music. And he was animated and jumping around and having a great time. And I turned to my father and I said, oh, that's what I want to do. I want to be a conductor.
Okay, now what do you think that music's all about? Can you tell me?
I think I'm a pupil of Bernstein, and these big personalities never die. You can feel when you see a video of Bernstein that he's still there at the Lincoln Center conducting, or in Musikverein in Vienna or in Tanglewood. You feel that he's still around.
Okay, so there's a lot to him, clearly an inspirational character. Let's go back to the very start and his early years. So Louis Bernstein was born on the 25th of August, 1918 in Lawrence, Massachusetts. And his parents were Jenny and Sam, who you can see here. Sam was a hairdressing supplies wholesaler. His grandmother insisted that his first name was Louis, but his parents always called him Leonard and his friends called him Lenny. Sam was the oldest of four children and grew up in a farm in a shtetl in Ukraine, about halfway between Kyiv and Lviv, so in the western part of Ukraine. He came from a long line of rabbis and was deeply religious and scholastic, but he disliked the claustrophobic strictness of the traditional environment. Sam went to yeshiva, and he did actually think about becoming a rabbi, but at age 16, he left his home without even saying goodbye to his parents and moved to America. Jenny was born just 21 miles away from Sam, and very unusually for a girl in that environment, was tutored in both Hebrew and Russian. She was bright, lively, and imaginative. She came to America age 7, with her mother and younger siblings, and worked in a textile mill in appalling conditions. Sam and Jenny met when Jenny was 18. So she, as you can see here, is attractive. She was a spirited woman. He was ambitious and intelligent, but he was contemptuous of her family's rather simple background. Despite that, they married in 1917. So she was free-spirited. He was devout, intense, rule-bound, driven, sometimes a bit harsh, so often stern and judgmental, gloomy and controlling. Yet, at parties when Jewish music played, he would dance in an ecstatic Hasidic manner. Jenny, on the other hand, was interested in food and movies and romantic novels and gossip. And she dreamt of socializing with elegant people, felt trapped by Sam's penny pinching. And their different outlooks led to frequent arguing. They even had a trial separation when Bernstein was just 4. Once he describes how he placed himself between his parents when they were rowing and Sam was holding a bottle and actually threatening Jenny. Bernstein was very close to his younger sister, perhaps because of this. These are the only pictures I could find of her, so none when they were children. She was born in 1923, called Shirley. And their friendship was lifelong. And in fact, her feelings for him were stronger than for any other male she never married. They had a younger brother, Burton, who was born in 1932 when Bernstein was 13. In 1923, the family joined this synagogue at the Mishkan Tefillah Temple in Boston. This is actually the first conservative synagogue in Boston and popular amongst Eastern European Jews who have become financially successful. It explicitly supported liberalism, Zionism, and social activism. It had an organ and mixed choir, and Sam became its vice president. Bernstein had a pretty thorough Jewish education. He began studying Hebrew aged 8, had his bar mitzvah in 1931. And the custom was to use a standard speech. He didn't. He wrote his own and delivered it in Hebrew, a really eloquent talk in Hebrew about his parasha. Now, he was first captivated by live music in 1928, age 10, when he heard this guy. This is the cantor of a shul. His name is Solomon Braslavsky. He was a visiting and singing at the shul. He was actually a professor at the Jewish Theological Seminary and a brilliant composer. Now, Braslavsky had a great baritone, and this really complimented the organ and choir. And it so overwhelmed Bernstein that he found he was crying. And he became his first musical mentor. Same year, Sam's sister Clara sent her unwanted upright piano to Bernstein's house, and he just couldn't stop playing. He took lessons and quickly showed exceptional ability. He made up his own system of harmony, improvised songs he heard on the radio. He was able to pick up tunes instantly and was a superb sight reader. Jenny always loved music and was often emotionally moved by his playing. He started to compose age 12 and would play her different versions and ask which she liked best. Sam initially opposed Bernstein's interest in music, especially his playing late into the night. And in fact, as late as 1943, Sam thought that Bernstein should give up music and take up a proper job, which meant working for him in his hairdressing supplies business. When Bernstein eventually became famous, Sam defended himself to a reporter by making this famous quote, "How could I know my son would grow up to be Leonard Bernstein?" He entered the prestigious Boston Latin School in 1929, where he won many awards, including a prize for excellence in music. But his real musical development was outside school, where he arranged Russian and Hebrew melodies and put on theatrical productions with friends. So he was very different to most other American musicians of the time who kind of gave up on their Judaism. For him, it was an essential part of his identity. This is a picture of him, by the way, conducting the first time at a summer camp. And you can see him with his hands up. He started studying with a new piano teacher called Helen Coates, who became Bernstein's lifelong secretary. And she meticulously chronicled his next 55 years. 1935, he went to Harvard to study music. He attended the academic classes only sporadically, waiting until the last moment to do his assignments. And then he did that by writing feverishly through the night. Yet he still did brilliantly. He was headstrong and loved to be the center of attention. He once disrupted a class by insisting that Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, should have notated a G sharp as an A flat. So Bach had got it wrong in Bernstein's eyes. He performed regularly, both on his own and with the Massachusetts State Symphony, and praised in the press for his virtuosic brilliance and profound interpretation. He also accompanied silent films, once getting a standing ovation from 1,000 Harvard students for his improvised performance of Eisenstein's Battleship Potemkin. During this time, he met many renowned musicians who were a major influence on him. This guy here is Aaron Copland, who a really famous American composer and conductor, also Jewish, became Bernstein's long-term mentor and briefly was his lover as well. He graduated in 1939. This is his graduation photo. And his final year thesis was called "The Absorption of Race Elements into American Music." And this argued that jazz was the first truly American form of music. And later on, he was to actually compose some jazz himself. So I thought I'd play you a clip from this one, which is called Prelude, Fugue and Riffs. Thank you. In autumn 1939, he moved to Philadelphia to study conducting under Fritz Reiner. And then in 1940, he was the first time he went to the Boston Symphony Orchestra Summer Institute at Tanglewood. And there he studied in the conducting class of Sieg Kusevitsky. He graduated in 1941 from this with the only A grade that Reiner ever gave to a student in conducting. So a brilliant student, and quite a good looking guy, as you can see. He failed to find employment in Boston. So he moved to New York, where he worked for a publishing company under the pseudonym Lenny Amber. Bernstein is Amber in German. And there he transcribed music, he produced arrangements, and he played piano for dance classes. But this was nothing. His career was drifting. He was appointed assistant conductor at the New York Philharmonic Orchestra. But this was kind of like an honorary thing. In principle, the assistant conductor could step up, but it never happened. He was just a sort of backup insurance policy. And in fact, on the 13th of November, 1943, he actually held a premiere of his song cycle called I Hate Music, which fortunately, I have to say, we haven't got time to play. And to celebrate that, he partied that night until 4 a.m. and had a huge hangover. 5 hours later, he was called and told that he was conducting that evening after the guest conductor, Bruno Walter, came down with flu. So as I said, although the assistant conductor could in principle take over any concert, this had never previously happened. He was just 25 years and there was no time for a rehearsal. The concert was also broadcast nationally on CBS radio. And at the end of it, he got a standing ovation from both the audience and orchestra. So overnight, he'd become instantly famous. He featured on the front page of the New York Times, and he loved all this attention. In Pittsburgh, a couple of months later, he conducted the premiere of his Jeremiah Symphony, which included a vocal solo of the Hebrew text of Lamentations. And in May that year, it received the New York Critics Circle Award for the best New York work of the season. And the comment was here, "We were all bowled over by Bernstein's conductorial talent, especially the lightning, almost explosive physical energy, his ability to abandon himself totally to the music and yet not lose technical control." You can see from this picture how he got into it. I'll show you a live clip later on. And this was so unusual. Everyone else conducted in very formal ways. And here he was just releasing all his emotional energy into it. So in 1945, he was a guest conductor with 14 different American orchestras. He was clearly the up and coming conductor. He wrote at this time, Hashkivenu, which is a 5-minute piece and commissioned by the cantor of the Park Avenue Synagogue. And it was his only work which he explicitly wrote for synagogues. I've got a modern day rendition of this on its 70th anniversary. So you can see he was clearly into his religious side. He was very familiar with all this prayers. I can't see that particular tune catching on in my synagogue. I don't know about yours, but he recorded Ravel's piano concerto in G as a soloist and conductor with the Philharmonia Orchestra. And in 1945, he conducted opera for the first time with the American premiere at Tanglewood of Benjamin Britten's Peter Grimes, which had actually been commissioned at Tanglewood. 1947, he conducted for his first time in Tel Aviv, and that began a lifelong association with Israel. He was staunchly Zionist, he spoke modern Hebrew, and felt deeply at home in the country. And in fact, in 1948, he gave 40 concerts in 60 days in Israel during the independence war. In fact, there's a story, at one time he was rehearsing outside Be'er Sheva, and the Egyptians thought it was a military operation going on, because what were all these funny, this group of people walking around in this way for? His second symphony, The Age of Anxiety, had its premiere in 1949, received mixed reviews. It's based on W.H. Auden's poem of the same name, which included the first explicit poetic reference to the Holocaust in English. He toured Europe in 1949. And now the previous year, he refused to conduct in Vienna because of Austria's association with the war. But he now followed Yehudi Menuhin's lead in performing as a Jewish musician in a former Nazi territory. And his May the 9th concert with the Bavarian State Orchestra provoked a frenzied response. He was carried through the streets as a hero. He gave two concerts at a refugee camp, conducting an orchestra of homeless Dachau survivors. 1949, December, he made his first television appearance as a conductor with the Boston Symphony Orchestra at Carnegie Hall. This is a picture of him with his sister Shirley in the green room at Carnegie Hall. And this concert, which also included an address by Eleanor Roosevelt, the widow of the president, celebrated the anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You can see he's really motivated by social activism. He was a visiting music professor between 51 and 56 at Brandeis University, and he founded its Creative Arts Festival there. He was the first American conductor to appear at La Scala in Milan, and this is the time when he first conducted Maria Callas. 1957, he became the first American-born music director and conductor of the New York Philharmonic. So all the predecessors have been foreign-born, like Mahler and Toscanini. And he held that position until 1969. And he conducted over 1,200 concerts with them, toured widely. In 1961, he conducted at President Kennedy's pre-inaugural gala, and he was an occasional guest at the White House. And it's quite interesting, those two, actually. I think they're quite similar. They're both American leaders in their 40s from Boston and Harvard, and they led very public lives, intelligent, came across as fearless, and were charismatic. But they also had a need to have people around them, and I suppose the capacity to have many types of relationship. They both had sexual secrets. When Kennedy was assassinated, the day afterwards, 23rd November 63, Bernstein conducted a nationally televised memorial featuring Mahler's Second Symphony. He also conducted the funeral mass in 68 for Robert Kennedy, the brother of the president, ignoring a death threat he received on the morning of the funeral. So Mahler, he was often considered to be the person who'd rescued Mahler. Mahler, a Jewish composer, and he certainly had a strong affinity with him. So I've actually got a clip from the fifth movement of the Second Symphony here. almost seems to me to be having a sort of religious, ecstatic experience there, and pulling that performance out of the musicians. Astonishing. Let me...
Computer had a little moment.
Right, fine. I'm sorry about... Well, you just heard a fantastic... Actually, the best thing about that clip was him conducting. You didn't... if that should be the closing of Yom Kippur or something for me. Never doing, all coming down.
I think there was something a bit more impressive than his all his magnified movements, which are rather frowned on now. Wow. Did you notice there was no score?
Yes.
And he was doing it all from memory. And that is really impressive.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Does anyone else have any comments or questions at this stage? No. Okay. All right. So let me...
Overwhelmed by the genius. Overwhelmed by his genius.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it gets better, I have to say. So he was strongly committed to the Philharmonic, clearly. I mean, 1,200 concerts. Loads of other activities he was doing. So little time for composition. But he took a sabbatical in 64 to 65. And in that, he composed two major works, both in Hebrew, the Kaddish Symphony and the Chichester Psalms. So I'm going to play you a clip from the Chichester Psalms. So Chichester Psalm, we're going to hear Psalm 23. And you've got the Hebrew and the English there. Yeah. Incidentally, he insisted that whenever this is sung, it has to be sung by a boy with a high voice like that. Has anyone got any ideas why he insisted that that had to be sung by a boy?
Because of a timbre, I think, is that, you know, they used to have a costrass, I don't know what they call them in English, you know, the singers. During the Renaissance particular era when
that's a good guess. That's not the reason. Someone say something?
Castrato they used to have, because they can then actually reach a particular height.
Well, that's right, these weren't castrato, because these weren't people, these were boys who could reach that. But why did he want a boy to do that? Why could it not be done by a woman?
It's to do with his sexuality.
No. It's to do with who is supposed to be saying this? Who was supposed to have written this?
King David.
Yes, but as a boy. So this is when he was first met. So he actually wanted to recreate that, that idea of David as a boy. That's who it's written for, I suppose. So that's what he insisted. Even today, it has to be done that way. So carrying on with his amazing career, he was one of the first conductors to film his performances, starting with Verdi's Requiem, actually in St. Paul's Cathedral in London. And these films proved very financially lucrative and opened up music to large new audiences. In 1971, he premiered his Mass, which had been commissioned by Jacqueline Kennedy, the widow of the president. It was written for an orchestra, and a rock and a brass band, and its theme was the difficulty in sustaining faith in a time of human atrocity. Apparently, at the end of the premiere, the audience was silent for 3 minutes and then cheered for 30. it's really had mixed reactions. It's quite, you can sense the music I'm playing is classical music. It's not easy to get into. You've got to be in a certain frame of mind. Something you may not have realized, he was a brilliant teacher. On the 14th of November, 1954, he gave his first lecture for the CBS arts program called Omnibus, which was a live program directed at adults, which explained Beethoven's Fifth Symphony with the aid of musicians. And he gave a further 6 lectures in the series. He then became a well-known figure in the States through his series of 53 televised young people's concerts for CBS. And these were the first and most influential series of music appreciation programs on TV. He was responsible for introducing classical music to millions of people. And he really wanted the audience to feel the power and subtlety and joy of music and realize that they needed music in their life. The first of these concerts was on the 18th of January, 58, and was called What Does Music Mean? And he concluded, the way that music makes us feel when you hear it, if it tells us something, not a story or a picture, but a feeling, if it makes us change inside, then you're understanding it. We can't always name the things we feel. Sometimes we can, but every once in a while, we have feelings that are so deep that we have no words for them. And that's where music is so marvelous, because music names them for us only in notes instead of words. I mean, this is really religious, the way he's talking about it, in my view. Now, these talks are fantastic. They're each about an hour long, and that's all on YouTube. And if you're into music, I would thoroughly recommend you listening to some of them. I'm going to play you the clip from the first of these talks, from the start of it, just so you get a feeling for what he was doing.
Now, what do you think that music's all about? Can you tell me? That's just what I thought you'd say. Cowboys, bandits, horses, the Wild West. I know my little daughter, Jamie, who's 5 years old and who's sitting up there, agrees with you. When she heard me play this piece, she said, "Ooh, the Lone Ranger song. I owe Silver." Well, I hate to disappoint her, and you too. But it really isn't about the Lone Ranger at all. It's about notes, E flats and F sharps. You see, no matter how many times people tell you stories about what music means, forget them. Stories aren't what music means about at all. Music is never about anything. Music just is. Music is notes, beautiful notes and songs put together in such a way that we get pleasure out of listening to them. That's all there is to it. And when we ask, what does it mean? What does this piece of music mean? Then we're asking a very hard question. And that's the question we're going to try to answer today. Now, it's a funny thing about this meaning business, in music anyway. When you say, what does it mean? What you're really saying is, what is it trying to tell me? What ideas does it make me have? Just like words. When you hear words, you get ideas from them. If I say to you, oh, I burned my finger, then immediately you get an idea from what I said, or some ideas. You get the idea that I burned my finger, that it hurts, that I might not be able to play the piano anymore, or that I have a loud, ugly voice when I scream. Lots of different ideas like that. That's words. But if I play you notes, just notes on the piano like that, those notes don't tell you any ideas. Those notes aren't about burning your finger or Sputniks or lampshades or rockets or anything. Well, what are they about? They're about music. For instance, take this piece by Chopin. Beautiful, isn't it? But what's it about? Nothing. Or take this Beethoven sonata. That's not about anything either. Or take this piece of Boogie Woogie. It's not about anything either. They're none of them about anything, but they're all fun to listen to. Why should they be fun to listen to? I don't know, it's just part of human nature to like to listen to music. You see, notes aren't like words at all, because if I say one single word all by itself to you, like rocket, immediately you have an idea, you see a picture in your mind. Rocket, bang, picture. But if I play a note, one note all alone, that means nothing. It's just a plain old F sharp or a B flat, a sound, that's all. Higher or lower, louder or softer, a sound that can seem very different if I play it, or if I sing it, or if an oboe plays it, or if a xylophone plays it, or if a trombone plays it. Very different.
Just amazing. Each time I listen to that, I'm just sort of taken in with him. And you can see the kids are as well. Fantastic teacher, really. So he had this infectious enthusiasm when he spoke, and he shed real insight into the creative process. You can see he was passionate about communicating, and his informal style made him extremely effective at connecting with people. He would often turn around to the audience and tell them that they hadn't got the emotion. And he would play the music again so that they really listened to it. Now, let's move on now to his popular music, which is what he's now best remembered for. His first commercially successful piece was his score to the ballet Fancy Free, which was choreographed by Jerome Robbins and opened in New York in April 1944. Bernstein conducted, and it got 24 curtain calls. The work was later developed into the musical On the Town, and that ran for 463 performances on Broadway. This was the first racially integrated musical on Broadway. In 1950, he wrote the lyrics and the music to Peter Pan, and that ran for 321 performances on Broadway. And then in 1953, he produced the score to the musical Wonderful Town at very short notice. He also wrote the music to the film On the Waterfront, starring Marlon Brando. In 1956, he composed the music for the opera Candide, which was based on Voltaire's novella. And I'm going to pick one tune from this for you to listen to. It's called I Am Readily Assimilated. And it really does sound like Yiddish. It's clearly got his roots in it. Bernstein's conducting this.
Now I'm here, I'm dancing a tango. am easily assimilated. I am so easily assimilated. I never spoke a human language. My father spoke high middle Polish. In one half hour I talk in Spanish. Por favor, Toreador, I am easily assimilated.
And of course, amongst his best known works is the music for West Side Story, which premiered on Broadway in 1957. I don't know if you know the origins of this, actually. Do you know what it was originally? It was originally going to be called East Side Story. Does anyone know why? It was originally going to be about the battle between Catholics and Jews, or the conflict between Catholics and Jews in the East Side of New York. Over Pesach, so very appropriate for now, Pesach and Passover. But they switched it to LA to actually get rid of the Jewish connotations, as they thought that was not going to be as accessible for people. Its key theme is still, however, the futility of intolerance, which was very relevant to Bernstein, who had experienced both anti-Semitism and sexual intolerance. And he clearly was the child also of an immigrant family which had experienced marital tension. Its opening run was 734 performances. It toured for a year, then returned to Broadway for another 253 shows in 1960. So let's have a part of the overture to West Side Story. So let's now turn to his personal life.
In his music, do we know whether he was happy doing commercial stuff? Because his commercial stuff is so different from his classical music. And it's very unusual to get a composer that is, in a sense, equally happy in both genres.
Yes, I will touch on that. I think he felt completely split down the middle, really. He wasn't as adverse as, say, someone like George Gershwin, who really felt the popular music he did was taking away from his classical side. But then Gershwin wasn't a proper musician in some ways. He was clearly a huge classical musician in terms of all his conducting that he did, and has very high esteem from that point of view. But I think later on he would have felt he ran out of time and he could have composed some more classical music, which would have left him with a more the sort of legacy he would have hoped for. But having said that, who doesn't love West Side Story? So, and I think his classical music was received with mixed views, to be honest. It wasn't as easily accessible, or even didn't even amongst his classical peers, it didn't tick all the boxes. I suspect he was probably too talented. He would have been better off being a specialist, too talented in a wide range of areas. So anyway, this is a picture with him with Felicia Montalegro, who he met in 1946. And Felicia immediately fell in love with him. She says, the minute I saw him conduct, I knew it was true. The moment was the coming into focus of my whole being, the completing of myself. They kind of had a turbulent on-off engagement, and they only married in 1951, 5 years later, when he was 33. This is a picture of them in 59. Now, she'd grown up as a Catholic, but she did have an American Jewish father, and she converted to Judaism before their marriage without telling her parents. He needed to share his life with somebody, and he longed for a stable home life. And they mirrored, understood, and needed each other, really. She was accomplished and beautiful and warm and refined and emotionally available. She had the steadiness that gave him emotional stability. And their early years of their marriage were passionate and happy. They had three children, Jamie, Alexander, and Nina. And in fact, and a couple of them have musical careers themselves. He was also active in various left-wing causes and organizations in the 1940s, such that he was blacklisted by the US State Department and by CBS in the early 50s. And he was forced to sign a humiliating declaration saying that he had endorsed communist causes casually without knowing what the petitions he had signed had contained. He wasn't an extremist, more a sort of sentimental left-leaning liberal, and he didn't really have a coherent political ideology, as opposed to Felicia, his wife, who did. And she was a founder member of the American Civil Liberties Union, ACLU. She raised money for the poor in Chile and marched against the Vietnam War. And their political life received substantial press coverage due to a notorious meeting they held in their apartment in Manhattan in 1970 to raise funds for 21 arrested members of the Black Panther Party. Derogatory and demeaning articles were written, and the author Tom Wolfe coined the phrase radical chic to describe him. This is the article from a New York magazine at the time about this.
Is that the same Tom Wolfe who wrote Bonfire of the Vanities?
That is indeed the same one, yeah. So, yeah. So the Bernsteins were subjected to mockery and hate mail and picketing outside their home. He was even booed at the Philharmonic. Many of those attended the event had received letters outlining the anti-Semitic position of the Black Panthers, anonymously signed by a concerned and loyal Jew. Now, it later turned out all these letters were fakes. They were actually written by the FBI director, J. Edgar Hoover, who had a long-standing grudge against Bernstein and who he was trying to discredit. So dirty tricks, really. When it comes to Bernstein's sexuality, Felicia knew about this, even though it didn't become public for 25 years. And in an early letter, she wrote to him, "You're a homosexual and may never change. You don't admit to the possibility of a double life, but if your peace of mind, your health, your whole nervous system depends on a certain sexual pattern, what can you do? So I'm willing to accept you as you are without being a martyr or sacrificing to the Leonard Bernstein altar. Let's try to see what happens if you're free to do as you like. But without the guilt and confession, please." So she accepted him, amazing woman, really. In 74, she got breast cancer. And then in 76, he actually left her for a while. And he lived with the musical director of a classical music radio station. The guy was called Tom Cothran. That relationship didn't work out, and Bernstein moved back to her in 1977. And that's when she was diagnosed with lung cancer. And he cared for her until she died the next year, aged just 56. Now, her death left him depressed and rudderless and insecure. He often spoke about his guilt over his wife's illness and death. And he was adamant that she had been the greatest love of his life. His grief stayed with him for the rest of his life, though. And he kind of went off the rails. His lifestyle became excessive. He was frequently crude and predatory sexually. He drank heavily, embarrassed his friends. However, his public standing was unaffected, and he resumed his musical activities. So what was he like? Well, he and his music combined the traits of his parents, the religiousness, the traditionalism, the strength and dark moods of his father, with the sociability, warmth, gaiety, and love of glamour of his mother. He shared their intelligence and social liberalism. He excelled in many areas, hated routine, pursued simultaneously a range of goals, too many to realistically achieve. He was often conflicted when dealing with the different demands of composing, performing, and conducting. He said he had two personalities, that of the composer and that of the conductor. And the composer is an introspective person, a strong inner life. His personal mode of activity is to stay at home and compose whenever he wants. On the other hand, the conductor is an extrovert, dealing with audiences, orchestras, critics. When you find yourself being both a born performer and a born creator, you discover that you are supporting two lives and he's barely just keeping up with himself. With his conviction and organization skills, he was a natural method conductor. And he created this style of conducting I've tried to show you, which reflected his passion and exuberance. In contrast, he described composing as a subconscious act, when ideas came to him while sitting at the piano in a kind of trance. And then he would awaken to find pages full of notes. He composed quickly, and tight deadlines brought the best out of him, which is probably why he did his best work for commercial theatre rather than when he could create on his own. So I think those conflicting demands meant he didn't fulfill his true potential, and he was criticised as a theatrical populist rather than a serious composer. Now that deeply hurt him, and he had many doubts and insecurities. He was concerned that he would be remembered less as a composer and more as a conductor, and that his serious works would be overshadowed by his popular ones. In 1988, he told a reporter, "I can't assess myself or decide whether I have achieved everything or a portion or a fraction. I feel as though I have led many, many lifetimes and achieved more than I had any right to expect. Certain risks have to fail. What's amazing is that as many have worked. I don't know anybody who's been as lucky as I have." Personality-wise, he was extrovert, highly extrovert, animated, outspoken, dramatic, charismatic, physically attractive, a narcissist, and a showman with a high degree of self-regard, an extreme need to be loved and be the center of attention. His father remarked that it was lucky his son was not a woman, as he seemed incapable of saying no. He compulsively made friends with everybody. He was incessantly active, a night owl who didn't require much sleep. If not playing, he would be partying or having long, intense discussions about God or art or politics or sex. He lived fully in the moment. He frequently embarrassed and offended people with his vulgarity and lack of self-control, yet he also had a strong interest in others and insight into them. He evoked strong emotions. People either loved or hated him. He was difficult to be with, either as a friend or a sibling, a father, a spouse. The center of attention was him. He held clear political views, wasn't afraid to take unpopular stances. And he was an active member of the Committee for a Sane Nuclear Policy and an advocate of disarmament. A week before the 1988 US presidential election, between these two guys, anyone know who they are?
Bush Senior.
Yeah, on the right. Who did he face? Can you remember? He fell from the plane, didn't he? Michael Dukakis. and he published an article in the New York Times. And I thought you'd love the name of this article. It is, "I'm a liberal and proud of it." And here's a quote from this article. It's very appropriate for the synagogue. "I want to redefine the word liberal, not run from it, nor cower defensively as it's insulting abuse, but proudly to clarify it." So in America, liberal is a negative word, it's a word of criticism. And he's saying the word derives from the Latin liber, meaning free. Who fought to free the slaves? Liberals. Who succeeded in abolishing the poll tax? Liberals. Who fought for women's rights, civil rights, free public education? Liberals. Who stood guard and still stands guard against sweatshops, child labor, racism, bigotry, lovers of freedom and enemies of tyranny? The liberals. So best to be a liberal. He announced his retirement on the 9th of October, 1990, and died 5 days later, aged 72, from a heart attack. A long-term heavy smoker, he battled emphysema from his mid-1950s. Just as my voice is giving out, I want to end with my favorite Bernstein composition, which is Somewhere from West Side Story, which to me is about the need for belonging, which Bernstein never found, and which I find especially moving without the words. I mean, I think it's also a really strong Jewish theme running through this, of the issues of man versus women and people and God, people moving the land. Anyway, you can hear the tune. That's Bernstein.
Thank you.
Who was the orchestra playing there, if you know?
Which was the orchestra? I don't know. Sorry, I beg your pardon. Sure. I can find out. I'll find out.
Thank you.
Other than composing a few bits of obviously Jewish music, did Judaism play a role in his life? Well, not really.
Oh, I think so, yes. I do think so. I think he was, I mean, if you think of it, driven by social values, yeah, I do think that it was a really formative influence on him, actually. I mean, that he wanted his wife to convert. This is so unusual in the music industry, really. They were just kind of so glad to get rid of it. He didn't ever consider assimilating or changing his name. I think he was really proud of his Judaism. I mean, obviously his father was very frum, we would say, although not as very frum as his father. So he had a strong background. I think it was a very positive background as well, in terms of it wasn't just a formality, something to put up with and then run away from. So I think it was a positive thing for him, really.
Presumably, he wasn't observant.
No.
But that's part of the background, then.
More than that, I mean, isn't it like how we would say that non-Orthodox people today are Jewish? It's not through observance. That's not how we measure how Jewish you are. It is what you do with your Judaism, really. And I think he would say that he fought really strongly to uphold whatever values that he felt were in there. So, yeah, more the prophetic Judaism, I think, than the halachic Judaism. But, yeah.
How old was he actually before he started, getting money together, being commercially successful?
Yeah, so that would be about, I would say his late 20s, actually.
Quite early.
Yeah. I mean, what's astonishing about him, this one day which made him, this one concert. Mm. If he hadn't had that, that break of luck, who knows what would have happened. But this was him at his best. He had to rise to the occasion without preparation. And he was so superb at that, really. And I think, you know, the orchestra were worried. And he just, this young kid held them together, really. Young kid, he's in his mid-20s, but that's so young, really. That so really astonishing. And of course this was just at the start, the post-war period, where people kind of wanted a fresh new start. He was lucky in that way, I think, with his timing. It could break down barriers. People wanted something different. So Rodgers and Hammerstein hit the musicals in that way, in a very different way after that time. It was a good opportunity for them.
When you were talking about his
birth, did he have children, and who were they, and what happened to them?
Yeah, so he had three kids. Let me just get my notes out about them. So there was Jamie. Now she, as a music educator, she still regularly conducts her father's work. Alexander, he's a teacher of drama, and Nina, and she's actually works on Bernstein's archives. There was 300,000 papers in his archives because of this secretary who kept everything. And now she's a food educator. They're all still alive. They're born in the 50s and 60s.
Thank you.
When you were talking about his personality, sort of reminded me in many ways of Lenny Bruce. Wanting, prepared to shock people, political, didn't care what people thought of him, went his own way. I don't know how affable he was and how integrated with people as a whole, probably not, but he was a very strong character, certainly.
Yeah, I don't know anything about Lenny Bruce. I wouldn't say that Bernstein didn't care what people thought about him. I think he really craved people's adulation, but he was torn because that was intellectually dishonest. He felt he had to do his music as well, but he really, really wanted his music to be appreciated. And when it wasn't, I think he was really hurt by this, actually. And he felt he could do so much better if only he had the time and focused on one thing, but he didn't. I mean, I think he had ridiculous expectations of himself, really. He's really set the bar very high, and whatever he did in his own eyes, I don't think he would have felt he succeeded. he was probably really affected by his upbringing and the battles really between his parents. So he was craving security all the time whilst having these creative genes within you. And that led to an internal conflict, I think, which is never easy for anyone to manage. Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah, it was amazing. Thank you so much, Jonathan. It was brilliant. Lovely evening. Amazing.
Great evening. Yeah.
And thank you for being with us. Not quite off your sickbed. Really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Yes. Really appreciate it.
I'm just sorry I couldn't be in the room with you.
And just reminding everyone about the Audacious Jews books, which you can purchase on the Audacious. I don't know. Can you purchase your books on the audacious.com? Audacious Jews.
And it gives a link from there where you can purchase them. So if you go onto the website, it gives a link to Lulu, which is the best place to purchase them. Yeah.
Thank you so much. And we've got the last session in this series, and it's going to be about a lady, Rosalind, who I don't know much about, Franklin. And that's going to be an exciting session as well. Finishes the first series on high.
Indeed. So that is in 3 weeks' time, I think. She's a chemist, a scientist.
Right.
Who was involved in a discovery of DNA. And there's a big scandal around her. Was she taken out by sexism, or was she not really as creative as people think? So she's got an amazing story, really. And an English person as well. So that would be really...
Thank you very, very much, Jonathan.
Thank you.
I wish you to feel better.
Thank you.
And wish Lima.